Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the IGNA INVERS Webmaster Series 2021. We have entered into the webinar 2. This is completely a pediatric glomerular disease symposium. And the highlight of this program is we have a polling sessions. Totally, we have 7 polling sessions. And the dates are mentioned here. And the instructions of the polling sessions will be given later during the next webinar series before we take up the polling session. And the sessions would be spanning till July 14th. Today we have our first speaker, Dr. Nivedita Kamath. Dr. Nivedita Kamath is an assistant professor from the Department of Pediatric Nephrology from the prestigious Institute St. John's Medical College, Bangalore. And their area of interest is towards chronic kidney disease, chronic dialysis, and neonatal AKI. She is a honorary faculty at Kasturibai Medical College, Bangalore, and she is a member of ISPN Bulletin Editorial Board, and she is a member committee for priorities in low-income countries in IGNA. Welcome to Dr. Nivedita to take the session.
Thank you, Dr. Kalaivani, and gratitude to Namalwar sir and to the team at Mehta Children's Hospital me this opportunity to be a part of this unique program which is focusing on glomerular disease in children. Before I start, are my slides visible?
Yeah, your slides are visible, ma'am.
Okay. So today we are going to look at a very important aspect of glomerulus, that is the hemodynamics and how the glomerulus handles the massive amount of blood flow that comes to it to produce the glomerular filtrate, which is the initial part of production of urine. Of course, the hard work put in by the tubules cannot be underestimated, but today the focus would be on the production of the glomerular filtrate.
You have any difficulty in moving your slides forward?
Are the slides moving, Dr. Kale? I'm not able to see it.
I think you have put your slides in animation. It is just moving as department. Yeah, it's visible, ma'am.
Yeah, I am moving them.
It's moving forward.
Second slide, is it?
Okay. So the session plan for today will be to look at... Thank you. So the session plan for to look at glomerular filtration rate and its determinants, the regulation of glomerular filtration, and of course the most important part is to look at the aspects, the applied aspects of how we can apply what we learn about hemodynamics of the glomerulus in our clinical settings. The glomerulus, we know, is the starting part of the important functional unit of the kidney, that is the nephron. It is nothing but a tuft of capillaries that is enclosed within the Bowman space. But what makes it unique is the structure of the glomerulus, which begins and ends in an arteriole, unlike any other capillary tuft in the entire body. The most important components of the glomerulus are the endothelial cell, the visceral and the parietal epithelial cells, the visceral epithelial cells also known as the podocyte, and the mesangial cells which form a scaffold and support this glomerular capillary tuft. In addition, outside the glomerulus lies a very important extraglomerular apparatus which consists of the macula densa in the distal convoluted tubule, the afferent and the efferent arterioles, and the extraglomerular mesangium. And we'll see how this helps in the regulation of the glomerular filtration rate. When we look at the cross-section of the glomerular capillary, we see that it is made up of mainly 3 layers. The first is formed by the inner endothelial layer, the glomerular basin membrane, and the food processes of the podocyte. All these together form the glomerular filtration barrier, which is a charge and size selective barrier, and again has a very important role in modulating the function of the glomerulus and producing the glomerular filtration rate. However, this will be discussed subsequently in the next talk. What is unique about the blood flow to the kidney? How is it different from other organs? The kidney receives a large amount of the cardiac output, almost up to 20%, which accounts for about 1 liter per minute. We know that blood that comes to the kidney consists of the cellular elements and the plasma, and the plasma roughly accounts for about 55% of the blood flow, accounting to 625 ml per minute. If we look at blood flow per 100 gram of tissue, the kidney, perhaps after the lung, receives the second highest amount of blood, even more than the liver, the heart, and the exercising muscle. Now, why does the kidney receive so much of blood? It's not just to meet the metabolic demands of the kidney. Of course, the kidney is a very metabolically active organ, but also because the kidney is the major excretory organ, the major filtering organ, which removes the toxic and the unwanted material from the plasma in the form of glomerular filtrate. The blood flow, the maximum amount of blood flow goes to the cortex, which is about 90 to 95%. Only 5 to 10% goes to the medulla through the vasa recta. And it's very important that this is a small amount goes there to maintain the medullary osmotic gradient. The total glomerular filtration rate, as we say, is a product of the single nephron GFR. So we know that the nephron is one functional unit. Each nephron's GFR multiplied by the total number of nephrons is what gives us the glomerular filtration rate for the entire kidney. The glomerular filtration rate accounts for about 125 ml per minute, and it is roughly about 25% of the renal plasma flow. This fraction is called the filtration fraction, the fraction of the plasma that is taken out as the glomerular filtrate. And the body tries to keep this fraction, filtration fraction, constant at all times. What determines the blood flow to the kidney? We know that blood flow to the kidney comes from the aorta through the main renal artery, which then goes to form the segmental arteries, the interlobar arteries, the arcuate artery, and the interlobular artery. The interlobular artery then forms the afferent arteriole, which is the beginning of the glomerular capillary tuft. And the glomerular capillary tuft ends in the efferent arteriole. I'm having some problems with this. Sorry for the... The slides are not showing, actually. It's visible on the screen? Because I'm not able to see them.
Blood flow to the kidney, what is different is the slide is available. Next slide is
So again, as we said, the efferent arteriole then leads to the peritubular capillaries or the vasa recta, which is a low pressure circulation. Now, what is extremely unique about the kidney is that it has two sets of capillaries placed in series, which are joined by two arterioles, unlike any other system of blood supply in the body. The glomerular capillaries, as we see, are maintain a blood pressure at about 60 millimeters of mercury because the major function here is filtration. The peritubular capillaries have a very low pressure because the major function of the peritubular capillaries is reabsorption. Renal blood flow, if we recollect the laws of physics, is directly proportional to the difference in pressure and inversely proportional to the resistance that is given by the vessel wall. And here the unique part of the kidney, the blood supply to the kidney, is that it has two sets of arterioles, the afferent and the efferent, which provide this resistance to blood flow. And we'll see how changes in the afferent and the efferent arteriolar blood flow regulate the renal blood flow as well as the glomerular filtration. Again, what is important to remember is that resistance is inversely proportional to the fourth power of the radius. And no other organ utilizes this aspect better than the kidney. When we look at the blood pressures that are maintained at different parts of the renal vascular system, we see that the renal artery pressure is equal to the systolic pressure. It falls to about 60 millimeters of mercury at the afferent arteriolar level. And as you can see, it is maintained constant throughout the glomerular capillary tuft up to the efferent arteriole, after which, again, there is a drastic drop to about 20 millimeters of mercury when it enters into the peritubular capillaries. And this is to have the differential function of the glomerulus and the tubules. Now, if we were to straighten out all the capillaries in the glomerulus into a long hose pipe-like structure, we know that blood is flowing from one end and comes out of the other end, that is the afferent to the efferent arteriole. And in between, imagine that there are multiple holes in this hose pipe, which is leaking out the glomerular filtration. Now, what is it that allows this filtration to happen? By the Starling's forces, we know that in, like in any other capillary system, the most important is the glomerular hydraulic pressure within the capillaries, which is the PGC. And the colloid osmotic pressure within the vessels is what opposes the filtration. The colloid osmotic pressure is provided by the proteins or the albumin, which is there within the blood vessels. Another important factor that opposes filtration outside the glomerular tuft is the hydrostatic pressure within the Bowman's capsule. So the pressures that are marked in green are those favoring filtration, and the pressures that are marked in red are the ones opposing filtration. The colloid osmotic pressure within the Bowman's capsule should theoretically allow filtration to happen. But since the glomerular filtrate is in physiological conditions, a protein-free filtrate, the colloid osmotic pressure within the Bowman's capsule is practically zero. What we can see in this picture is that as the blood flows through the glomerular capillary tuft from the afferent to the efferent arteriole, the hydraulic pressure remains almost constant. But since the plasma is being filtered of solutes and water, the relative concentration of proteins increases. So as the blood flows through the capillary tuft and reaches the efferent arteriole, the colloid osmotic pressure increases, thereby increasing the opposing force to filtration. So the net filtration pressure at the efferent arteriole, which is nothing but the sum of all these pressures, is about 24 millimeters of mercury and higher than the net filtration at the efferent arteriole, which is about 10 millimeters of mercury. Now, if we take an average of this, the average net filtration pressure throughout the glomerular capillary tuft can amount to about 17 to 18 millimeters of mercury. But is this the only thing that determines the glomerular filtration? No, we also need to take care of other aspects, that is mainly the permeability coefficient, which is mainly brought about by the glomerular filtration barrier, and again will be discussed later, and the surface area of the glomerular capillaries. So you can imagine if the capillary tuft is in a pathological condition, sclerosed, or there's a focal sclerosis. So obviously that part of the surface area does not take part in the glomerular filtration. Hence the glomerular filtration would be affected. So the final equation for the glomerular filtration rate would be Ks into the net filtration pressure, which is the combination of the opposing and the permitting pressures within the glomerulus and the Bowman space. What are the aspects that regulate glomerular filtration under physiological conditions? So the most important determinant of the glomerular filtration rate is obviously the blood flow. So if there is low blood flow, then we know that the glomerular filtration is going to be affected. But this is then maintained by the filtration fraction. So under pathological conditions, when the blood flow is reduced, the kidney has various mechanisms to increase the filtration fraction and maintain the glomerular filtration rate. And we'll discuss that subsequently in the applied aspects. Other than this, we also have the hydraulic pressure within the glomerulus, or the PGC. Obviously, that is affected by the systemic blood pressure and the renal blood flow. And since the PGC is because of blood that is flowing into the glomerular capillary tuft, it will be increased by afferent arteriolar dilatation. What is important to remember is that efferent arteriolar constriction also increases the hydraulic pressure within the glomerulus. And the opposite, that is the efferent arteriolar constriction or efferent arteriolar dilatation, would reduce the hydraulic pressure within the glomerulus. Under pathological conditions, the Bowman capsule hydrostatic pressure could be increased. For example, if there is an obstruction of the tubules. And again, we'll see this in the applied aspects. That would oppose the filtration and reduce the GFR. In most physiological conditions, the colloid osmotic pressure is not altered, but for theoretical purposes, administration of colloids, say for example dextran or highly osmotic substances, can increase the opposing pressure of the colloid osmotic pressure and reduce the GFR. And the opposite of reduced albumin states could reduce the colloid osmotic pressure and favor glomerular filtration. What about the KS, or the permeability coefficient and surface area? So the surface area of the glomerular capillary tuft is also regulated by the scaffolding mesangial cells. So relaxation of the mesangial cells increases the surface area, and constriction reduces the surface area. And this is also important in some pathological conditions. Having looked at the various determinants, we need to now understand how the renal blood flow and the glomerular filtration, though they occur through the same pathway, are not regulated in the same manner. If we go back to what we discussed, that blood flow is inversely proportional to the resistance provided by the vessel, we can understand that since the afferent and the efferent arteriole are placed in series, the dilatation of either of these increases the blood flow, and the constriction of either of these reduces the renal blood flow. However, since the glomerular filtration happens in between the afferent and the efferent arteriole, the equation changes in the sense that afferent arteriolar dilatation and efferent arteriolar constriction increases the glomerular filtration. So they have to move in opposite directions to increase or decrease the glomerular filtration rate. This is an aspect to remember, so I've against it. Here you can see that the increased afferent arteriolar resistance or afferent arteriolar constriction reduces the renal blood flow and the net filtration pressure, and afferent arteriolar dilatation has the opposite effect. When it comes to the efferent arteriole, there is a dissociation between the renal blood flow and the GFR. Increased efferent arteriolar constriction, because it produces resistance to renal blood flow, reduces the renal blood flow but increases the net filtration pressure, and efferent arteriolar dilatation has the opposite effect. Other than these mechanisms, the kidney has the ability, like most organs in the body, to auto-regulate its blood pressure. This is again a very important protective mechanism to maintain the blood flow to the kidney constant, and as a corollary, also maintain the glomerular filtration rate constant at a range of blood pressure. The range is a little variable. Most books mention that it's about 80 to 120, and some say up to 160 millimeters of mercury. And what is important range may change. For example, in the neonates, the autoregulatory range at which blood pressure is maintained, blood flow is maintained constant, is different in comparison to a normal adult. And a hypertensive patient, again, the autoregulatory range would be set at a higher level. The two major mechanisms that maintain this autoregulatory property of the kidney is the myogenic response and the tubuloglomerular feedback. Now, what is a myogenic response? The myogenic response is an intrinsic response of the afferent arteriole. So in response to an increased arterial pressure, the blood vessel wall stretches. This causes calcium channels to open and increase in the intracellular calcium, in turn increasing the vascular resistance by muscle contraction or vasoconstriction, which in turn reduces the blood flow. So though this seems as a very basic mechanism, it accounts for about 50% of autoregulation in the kidney, and it's a very quick response. So whenever there is a rise in blood pressure, there is a myogenic response that occurs within as early as 3 to 10 seconds and regulates the blood pressure. What is important to know that is that it is attenuated in pathological conditions like diabetes following partial nephrectomy and is responsible for the hyperfiltration that happens in these scenarios. Next, we go to the tubular glomerular feedback. Let's again look at the juxtaglomerular apparatus, which plays an important role in the tubular glomerular feedback. As we said, we know that the glomerulus then proceeds to form the proximal tubule, the loop of Henle, the distal tubule, and the collecting duct, and so on. The distal tubule, as it comes in contact with the afferent efferent arteriole, and at this junction of the distal tubule with the arterioles, there is a change in the structure of the distal convoluted cells to form the macular densa cells. The extraglomerular mesangium in this area also has an important role in the juxtaglomerular apparatus. The third component of the apparatus is the granular cells of the afferent arteriole, which have two major functions. One is regulating the tubular glomerular feedback, and the other is the production of renin. Today, however, we'll be focusing on the tubular glomerular feedback. So what does the tubular glomerular feedback basically mean? The glomerular filtrate, as we know, consists of a lot of solutes and water. This sodium and chloride, which of course gets absorbed to a large extent in the proximal tubule, comes to the distal tubule. In the macular densa, this is sensed, and based on the amount of sodium and chloride, it regulates the GFR. So the sodium and chloride, and now a lot of emphasis is given on the role of chloride at this in the tubular glomerular feedback. Via the NKCC, or the sodium potassium 2 chloride channel that is present in the distal convoluted tubule, results in the activation of the sodium potassium ATPase at the basolateral side. This in turn action of ADP, AMP, and finally adenosine. Adenosine then goes into the interstitium, into the extraglomerular mesangial cells, acts on the A1 receptor there, and causes influx of calcium into the vessel wall or the granular cells of the afferent arteriole, causing vasoconstriction. Adenosine itself can cause direct vasoconstriction by its action on the afferent arteriole. This tubular glomerular feedback, wherein increased delivery of sodium and chloride to the macular densa, which in turn gives the macular densa a sense that the GFR has increased, results in a series of mechanisms which cause vasoconstriction of the afferent arteriole and reduce the GFR. This is activated by angiotensin, and we will see how it acts in pathological conditions, and is inhibited by, obviously, dilators of the afferent arteriole like nitric oxide and inhibitors of the sodium channel like furosemide. As we have discussed before, the glomerulus handles a huge volume of blood every minute, and it has to produce a huge amount of glomerular filtrate as well. This, if it's not very tightly regulated, can have devastating consequences. Both very low GFR or very high GFR, or gross fluctuations of GFR, we know can be detrimental to the body. So this needs to be regulated at multiple levels. And this is where the glomerular tubular crosstalk plays a very important role. So the glomerulus has crosstalks with different components of the tubules. The first is, of course, the proximal tubule, which is the glomerular tubular balance. The second is with the distal convoluted tubule, which is the tubular glomerular feedback. And the last is with the connecting tubule, which is the connecting tubular glomerular feedback. We've already discussed how the tubular glomerular feedback regulates the glomerular filtration. Let's look at the other two components. The glomerular tubular balance is a protective mechanism where an increase in GFR results in an increase in proximal tubular reabsorption. The exact mechanism how this happens is not very clear, but it is supposed to be mediated by flow-mediated activation of the channels in the proximal tubule, mainly the sodium-hydrogen exchanger. So increased GFR, we know if there is increased GFR, it can if the tubules are not going to reabsorb to the same extent, or it can cause a massive load of fluid and solutes to the tubules. So there is an increase in the proximal tubular reabsorption to prevent this. Like we said, that the distal convoluted tubule on its path towards the collecting duct comes in contact with the juxtaglomerular or the afferent and efferent arterioles at juxtaglomerular apparatus, and for mediating the tubuloglomerular feedback, it continues to form the connecting tubule, which again comes in contact with the afferent arteriole, and this is the place, the proximity of the to the afferent arteriole is where the connecting tubular glomerular feedback takes place. The main channel here again is a sodium absorption channel, which is the ENaC or the epithelial sodium channel. Of this epithelial sodium channel happens when there is an increased delivery of sodium to the connecting duct or the connecting tubules, and this results in the increased production of prostaglandins, resulting in an afferent arteriolar dilatation. So what is important to remember here is that the connecting tubular glomerular feedback, as opposed to the tubular glomerular feedback, causes afferent arteriolar dilatation, whereas the tubular glomerular feedback causes afferent arteriolar constriction. Again, it is tightly regulated by angiotensin, aldosterone, and inhibited by nitric oxide. What is the role of this connecting tubular glomerular feedback? So what is generally understood from these feedback mechanisms is that the tubuloglomerular feedback is an important mechanism, the glomerular tubular balance as well, to prevent loss of excess salt and water from the body. Because whenever the tubules detect loss of or a high amount of salt in the salt and water in the tubules, they reduce the GFR or they increase the absorption in the proximal tubule. Whereas suppose, like in our current situation where the salt intake in our diet is extremely high, suppose the tubuloglomerular feedback is the only mechanism, how can we excrete the salt? There is no way of doing that, right? Because whenever there is a high salt in the diet, that salt has to be excreted out of the body. So if there is an extra salt that comes out in the GFR and goes to the macular densa, activates the TGF and causes afferent arteriolar constriction, reducing the GFR. So there is no way in which this salt can get excreted. So to reset this or to prevent this from happening, the connecting tubular glomerular feedback has an important role. So this role is the role of the connecting tubular glomerular feedback is to balance the tubular glomerular feedback or reset the tubular glomerular feedback by causing afferent arteriolar dilatation. So it is easy to understand that abnormalities of the tubuloglomerular feedback and the connecting tubuloglomerular feedback can have important role in the pathophysiology of hypertension, and we'll see that soon. So these are the mechanisms of using the principles of physics within the kidney for regulation of GFR. But what about other hormonal and other autocoid mechanisms of extrinsic regulation of the GFR? This is mainly, again, using the properties of the resistance of the vessels, that is the afferent and efferent arterioles, by vasoconstrictors and vasodilators. The most important vasoconstrictor in physiological and pathological conditions is angiotensin II. It acts via the angiotensin I receptor and causes it afferent and efferent arteriolar vasoconstriction. But the efferent arteriolar vasoconstriction is much, much more than the afferent arteriolar vasoconstriction. Because of this, it reduces the renal blood flow, but helps to maintain the glomerular filtration rate. And this plays a very important role in many, many pathological conditions. It also reduces the surface area by causing mesangial contraction. And like any other system in the body, it also produces or increases the production of its counterbalance or counter-regulatory substances like prostaglandins and nitric oxide, and enhances the sensitivity to tubuloglomerular feedback. The next important vasoactivity. which is a very important protective mechanism, especially say in a condition like a hemorrhagic shock or a hypovolemic shock. There is intense sympathetic activation which causes afferent and efferent arteriovenous constriction, of course.
Niveda ma'am, do you mind switching off your video because your Wi-Fi is little
down?
Are you
able to see my slides?
We are able to see your slides, ma'am. Only one thing is it is getting broken. So it will be good if you can switch off your video.
Okay. Okay, yeah. Is it better now? Yeah. So, the other important vasoconstrictors are endothelin, which is doesn't have a major role in physiological conditions, but definitely in pathological conditions. Again, it causes vasoconstriction of the efferent arteriole and increases the glomerular filtration rate. It causes constriction of the mesangial cells and also, like angiotensin, increases the production of its substances. Adenosine, we have already discussed, acts via the adenosine receptor, causes constriction of the afferent arteriole. So that is what is important to remember here, and it reduces the GFR. Looking at the vasodilators, we see that prostaglandins cause the afferent arteriolar dilatation and are counter-regulatory substances to the intense vasoconstriction that is produced by the angiotensin and other vasoconstrictors. It helps in maintaining the GFR. Nitric oxide also is produced from the endothelial cells itself, and it causes afferent arteriolar dilatation. In response to volume expansion, atrial natriuretic peptide and dopamine-like hormones are produced, which result in excess help in vasodilatation to increase the GFR and salt and water excretion. So to summarize, the vasodilators are at the afferent arteriole, and vasoconstrictors at the efferent arterioles are important substances which increase the GFR. The vasodilators at the afferent arterioles are the prostaglandins and nitric oxide, and the vasoconstrictors at the efferent arteriole are angiotensin, endothelin, and the sympathetic activity or norepinephrine. Reduction in GFR is caused by vasoconstriction at the afferent arteriole by sympathetic activity, adenosine, inhibitors of prostaglandin like NSAIDs, and some other drugs like calcineurin inhibitors. And vasodilators at the efferent arterioles, which is mainly the ACE inhibitors, which are again, this property of ACE inhibitors is utilized in many pathological conditions, cause a reduction in the GFR. Very important to also understand the maturation of GFR, because we know that GFR, though all the nephrons are developed, there is no nephrogenesis that happens beyond 34 to 35 weeks of gestation. The GFR in the neonate is much lower. It's about 20 to 30 mils per minute per 1.73 meter square, as opposed to the adult GFR, which is almost 3 to 4 times that. Why is this so? And how does GFR mature from newborn to adult values? So this is because the fetal kidneys, if we go back and remember, the adult kidney receives about 20% of the cardiac output. In contrast, the fetal kidneys receive only 3 to 4%, and neonatal kidneys in the first week only about 8 to 10% of the cardiac output. Glomerular filtration, we know, happens by 10 to 11 weeks of gestation, but and urine production, of course, happens, but the glomerular filtration rate is extremely low. We know that nephrogenesis is completed in the term newborn at birth, so there is no further increase in the total number of nephrons. So the maturation of GFR or increase in GFR is only by an increase in the single nephron GFR. So what is it that causes the single nephron GFR to increase? The main factor here is an increase in renal blood flow. So if we look at renal blood flow, it doubles by 2 weeks of age and reaches adult values by about 2 years of age. And we know that the glomerular filtration rate also increases parallel to this. The increase in the renal blood flow, again, going back to the physics, is by an increase in systemic arterial blood pressure, which definitely happens as the baby grows, but also, most importantly, by a reduction in the renal vascular resistance. A minor contribution is there by the increase in the surface area of the capillaries and the glomerular hydrostatic pressure. The renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system has a very important role in the development of the kidney, and we have heard this in the previous lecture, and is upregulated in the fetus and neonate. And this high angiotensin level is what maintains the GFR at a very low renal blood flow. This is a physiological condition in which the angiotensin is maintaining the GFR in the scenario of a low blood flow. The autoregulatory mechanisms are very well developed in a term newborn. However, the range at which the autoregulation happens is, of course, much lower than that of the adult. Let's look at some common case scenarios where we may be able to apply what we have discussed about glomerular hemodynamics. A boy with steroid-resistant nephrotic syndrome treated with ACE inhibitors has a significant reduction in proteinuria. So some of these answers may seem a little superfluous because we are only focusing on the glomerular aspects of glomerular hemodynamics for answering these questions. But of course, for example, in this, the filtration barrier plays an important role. In some other places, the role of the tubules may be there, which I'm not going to discuss. We are only focusing on how the glomerular hemodynamics plays a role in this, in these case scenarios. ACE inhibitors reduce proteinuria by reducing the glomerular filtration rate. So we know that angiotensin II maintains the efferent arteriolar constriction, and ACE inhibitors obviously oppose that. So by preventing the constriction, it reduces the intraglomerular pressure, which is the driving force for increased GFR and proteinuria. And it's important to remember that this effect is independent of its antihypertensive effect. Proteinuria and hypertension, we know, are important predictors of outcome in all glomerular diseases, and we'll see this in the subsequent lectures. But what is the role of the kidney in potentiating these factors, especially hypertension? So we have seen that the tubuloglomerular feedback and the connecting tubuloglomerular feedback maintain a balance to prevent excessive or prevent reduced salt excretion. Important role in hypertension. So obviously it has an important role, especially in salt sensitive hypertension. If the connecting tubuloglomerular feedback is exaggerated, it increases the glomerular pressure, resulting in further damage to the glomerulus, and which is one of the important mechanisms of progression of kidney disease. Whereas a low or absent CTGF causes an exaggerated tubuloglomerular feedback response, which causes salt and water retention, in turn worsening the hypertension. In conditions like proteinuria, in obesity, one of the important mechanisms for proteinuria is an exaggerated CTGF. Most of these interpretations that I've presented here are from animal studies and have not been proven in human beings, but the physiology seems to be similar. Autoregulation, as we said, is reset to a higher level of blood pressures in hypertensive patients, and impaired autoregulation is seen in several pathological conditions like diabetes, salt-sensitive hypertension, and CKD. And it's an important mechanism by which the hypofiltration and the further damage, that is progression of CKD, happens. Here's a 10-month-old boy with acute diarrhea, dehydration, who presents with oliguria and creatinine. Now, if we can imagine that if we were to do a biopsy, the glomeruli will obviously be normal. But why is the GFR then reduced? So here is the role of the tubuloglomerular feedback. We know that acute tubular injury because of hypovolemia or a reduced effective circulating volume causes damage to the proximal tubule. So there's reduced salt and water reabsorption. This results in an increased delivery of salt and sodium chloride to the macula densa, triggering the tubuloglomerular feedback. Also, in an acute situation of hypovolemia, like for example in a hemorrhagic shock or severe dehydration, there is sympathetic activation, release of renin from the granular cells of the juxtaglomerular apparatus, which in turn causes the release of angiotensin II, which increases the PCT reabsorption of sodium and increases the sensitivity to the tubuloglomerular feedback, worsening the oliguria and achaia. Similarly, nephrotoxic injury that is caused, say, in a three-year-old child who is being treated with aminoglycosides. In addition to the activation of the tubuloglomerular feedback, there is also tubular obstruction by the denuded cells or the abnormal cells of the tubular epithelium that can cause a increase in the hydrostatic pressure within the Bowman's capsule, which opposes the glomerular filtration rate. Some nephrotoxins can have direct effects on the glomerulus, for example, aminoglycosides, resulting in mesangial cell contraction and loss of the charge selectivity also. So there are several other mechanisms also which contribute, but the glomerular hemodynamics play a very important role. A two-year-old child with diarrheal dehydration doesn't have AKI, but he's given nimesulide for treatment of fever and then presents with AKI. So what do you think went wrong in the glomerular hemodynamics in this situation? So we know that this is a dehydrated child who has a reduced effective intravascular circulating volume. In this child, the glomerular filtration, if it's maintained at a normal level, it's by the activation of the angiotensin, which causes the efferent arteriolar constriction, and prostaglandins, which cause the afferent arteriolar dilatation. Now, COX inhibitors inhibit this counterbalancing effect of the prostaglandins and hence result in a reduction in GFR. So this is a very important aspect to remember, that ACE inhibitors and COX-2 inhibitors or NSAIDs are going to place a patient at risk of AKI when they are in a high renin-angiotensin-aldosterone state. A neonatologist wants to treat PDA in a neonate with indomethacin but is worried about AKI. So why are neonates at higher risk of AKI due to these agents? Like we said, again, in the neonate, it's a physiological activation of the RAS and the prostaglandin system, which is maintaining the GFR. So any inhibitors of the system would compromise the GFR. A neonate with perinatal asphyxia is given a single dose of theophylline based on recent evidence that it reduces the risk of AKI. So what are the actual mechanisms in the glomerular hemodynamics that bring about this? So the hypoxemia that occurs, in addition to many other vasoconstrictors, also increases the intrarenal adenosine, which causes the afferent arteriolar constriction, reducing both the renal blood flow and the glomerular filtration. Of course, it is initially a protective mechanism to divert blood flow towards the more important vital organs like the brain, but over a period of time, it can cause AKI. Theophylline, being an adenosine receptor antagonist, opposes this action of this particular vasoconstrictor at the level of the glomerulus and maintains the GFR. So what are the new things that are come in the applied aspects of glomerular filtration rate or the hemodynamics? We know that SGLT inhibitors are now the rage and are being used in adults with diabetic CKD and have found to be very useful drugs. So new mechanisms of the high glucose, which is detected by the macular densa via the SGLT, which increases the neuronal nitric oxide synthase and blunts the GF, is proposed to be one of the important mechanisms for hyperfiltration, which is one of the earliest changes of diabetic nephropathy. And so it stands to reason that the SGLT inhibitors would oppose this mechanism of hyperfiltration and prevent the progression of CKD. Similarly, the nephrons, when they regulate their GFR, they don't do it individually, but they communicate with other nephrons through the electrical communications which run along the vascular tree and form a nephrovascular unit. And the most important is the aspect of the renal functional reserve, which is an important aspect. The loss of renal functional reserve is now considered to be the first step in CKD. It's the capacity of the kidney to increase its GFR beyond the baseline. And this is proposed to be because of afferent arteriolar dilatation. The exact mechanisms have not been understood, but probably resetting of the TGF and increase in production of vasodilators has been proposed as the mechanism. So we can see that renal hemodynamics is not just simple physics, but has a lot of applied aspects as well. To summarize, renal blood flow is regulated by systemic arterial pressure and renal vascular resistance, which are offered both by the afferent and the efferent arteriole. Glomerular filtration is regulated by the glomerular hydraulic pressure and ultrafiltration coefficient. The major regulators of GFR are again the afferent and the efferent arteriole, but they are not in the same manner as they regulate the blood flow. Autoregulation, an important aspect of preserving the GFR, is brought about by myogenic response and tubular glomerular feedback. GFR is modulated by vasoconstrictors and vasodilators, the most important here being angiotensin. There is a lot of crosstalk between the tubules at various levels with the glomeruli to titrate the glomerular filtration. And GFR in neonates matures because of a parallel increase in the renal blood flow. Thank you for a patient hearing, and I apologize for the technical glitches that happened. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was an excellent talk, taking us into the glomerular hemodynamics. Thank you, ma'am, for taking us from bench to bedside. It has showed that it had a lot of clinical values too. Namalwa, sir, do you have anything to add on, sir?
Good day. Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, we are able to hear you, sir.
So wonderful lecture, ma'am. Really, she has gone in depth into the not only the physiology, but also the molecular basis of all the physiological functions. It's an excellent presentation, ma'am. Thank you very much.
We'll move on to the next lecture.
Thank you, sir.
We'll move on to the next lecture. The next lecture is by Dr. Ranjit Tarakonda. He's a senior advisor pediatrics, and he's a pediatric nephrologist at INHS Ashwini, Mumbai. He is also a PhD scholar, graduated from AIIMS, New Delhi. His interest is towards CACUT, UTI, VUR, bowel bladder dysfunction, and renal genetics. His award is like commendation by the Chief of Naval Staff. Over to Dr. Ranjit. Dr. Ranjit, you are there?
Yeah. Are you able to hear me?
Yeah, we are able to hear you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Kalayavani. Thank you very much for the entire team at Mehta Children's Hospital. For firstly keeping academics alive at this time. You know, everyone had gone into a different mode altogether, and it's a privilege to speak on this forum. Are you able to see my slide? Yeah. So this is the overview of the presentation. So I'll be giving a brief overview of the kidney and the glomerulus, which Dr. Nivedita has already done. I'll be describing each component of the glomerular filtration barrier, talking about some models of glomerular filtration, and then some method mechanisms of glomerular injury. Now, since there is a lot of cell biology and there's a lot of basic science involved, I'll be breaking the monotony with some memes and cartoons. Coming to the overview, we can look at, if you think very defensively, we can think of the glomerular filtration barrier as a defending football team, which is trying to save its goal, saving the ball from going into the goal. The ball being the albumin molecule and the goal being the renal urinary space, the primary urine. So as we know, I think I'm using the same diagram as Dr. Nivedita. The kidney takes in 20% of the cardiac output. It has 1 to 2.5 million nephrons. Each nephron consists of a filtration unit called a glomerulus and a reabsorption compartment called a tubule. Now, the word glomerulus comes from the word glomus in Latin, which means a ball of yarn. So it's like a ball of yarn which has been kept inside a cup, which is nothing but the Bowman's capsule. Now, what are the components of the glomerulus? It is the glomerular endothelial cells, the podocytes, the mesangial cells, and the parietal epithelial cells. Of course, the glomerular endothelial cells and the podocytes are separated by a glomerular basement membrane, which we'll be talking about as well. So what is this barrier which everyone is talking about? There is just a 1 meter squared surface area in the kidney, which is producing 180 liters of urine every day, of which 10 to 16 grams is being saved of protein. So 10 to 16 grams of protein is being filtered every day. In a lifetime, this amounts to about 4 million liters of urine and 250 tons of proteins. And this filter somehow does not ever get clogged. Those of us who use cars know that even once in 3 months, our filters, our oil filters, our air filters, everything gets clogged. But this is one filter which just does not get clogged. So this is, in a way, such an effective mechanism which we have never even been able to reproduce in vitro. All the blood purification techniques which we do, dialysis, hemofiltration, they are nothing in front of a natural kidney. So coming to the first layer of defense, we can think of the endothelium as the midfielder who's actually taking the ball away right from the very beginning and taking it into the other side of the field. The glomerular endothelium is a little different from the endothelium of the rest of the body. It is a highly perforated endothelium. It has these structures called the fenestrae. Now, the word fenesta in Latin means a window. These fenestrae are 80 into 100 nanometers and they account for about 20% of the surface area of the glomerulus. So, how does a molecule which is just 8 into 8 into 3 millimeter not escape? Now, why we are so worried about albumin? Why do we keep talking about albumin? This is because, like, the hydrogen atom is key to quantum physics. That way, albumin is key to the glomerular filtration barrier because we know that we measure kidney damage in terms of albuminuria. So, how does albumin not escape these large holes? Now, if we look very carefully in this diagram, we can see that the endothelium has got a lattice of negatively charged glycoproteins. On top of that, some plasma protein get adsorbed and they form a layer which is about 200 nanometer thick, which is called the endothelial surface layer. Now, this endothelial surface layer is negatively charged. So, is it just that this negative charge repels the albumin away? This is what we've been taught from our undergraduate days. We'll discuss this subsequently. Now, one important thing is that the vascular growth factors have been recognized to be very important in the development as well as the upkeep of the glomerular endothelial cells. So, as we can see over here, that the podocytes talk to the glomerular endothelial cells using VEGF-A. The vascular endothelial growth factor I'll zoom in because even I'm not finding it a bit difficult to see. Yeah. So, as the glomerulus is developing, the VEGF-A, which is secreted by the podocyte, it actually attracts the endothelial precursors, which have got the VEGF-R receptor. Now, this, once even the glomerulus is developed, it is required for the maintenance of the endothelial cells as well. Angiopoietins are important for the development of the glomerulus again. Angiopoietin 1 acts on the Ti2 receptor of the endothelial cells to help the glomerulus develop. Angiopoietin 2 is an antagonist to this mechanism. SEM3A is a semaphorin, which actually is a vascular patterning molecule. And as we can see, VEGF-A, VEGFR2 axis is important for the angiogenesis as well as the survival of the glomerular epithelial cells. Similar to this, there is a VEGF-C, VEGF-3 axis, which is important for the development of the lymphatics of the kidneys. The angiopoietin, Ti2 are important for GC survival during development, but knockdown in animal experiments did not show any adverse effects. EGF, EGFR is important for cellular proliferation. Now, TGF, we'll come back here. The transforming growth factor is something which is secreted by the endothelial cells and it acts on the podocytes. Now, this is a mechanism which does not take place in health, it takes place in disease. And it, in a way, explains why whenever there is a vasculopathy, for instance, hemolytic uremic syndrome or preeclampsia, we also get a podocytopathy. The semaphorin is important for vascular patterning during development. And the CXCL12, CXCR47 pathway is important for the angiogenesis. Now, this same CXCL12, CXCR4 axis is also important for generation of new podocytes whenever there is a podocyte damage. But we will come to this later on. So, I mean, just to summarize, when the kidney is developing, or in fact, even when the kidney is mature, we require a good amount of VEGF to get the glomerulus flowing and going. During development, it's also important to have a fair amount of angiopoietin 1. So, anything which interrupts these mechanisms can have disastrous consequences on the development of the glomerulus. Now, coming to the second layer of defense, we can call them something like the BACIs, the glomerular filtration basement membrane. This is a fibrous and stratified matrix. It contains a large number of proteins. There are collagens, laminins, nitrogens, HSPGs. Now, I'll be talking about them again and again because these are words which are a bit difficult to remember. There is the tubulointerstitial nephritis antigen-like protein, which is also present in the glomerular basement membrane. And as we can see, the collagen 4 is located in the middle, but it is a little bit towards the endothelial side, while both sides of the collagen is bounded by the laminin 521. So it is something like a sandwich, but yes, there are two slices of bread on top and there's just one slice of bread at the bottom. The laminin is important for the communication with the podocyte with integrin. So it is believed that in many models that this glomerular basement membrane is something like an intermediary sieve. It also at the same time is not just a structural membrane. Now, the glomerular basement membrane as well as the proteins which are on the outer side of the podocytes were often thought to be just physical barriers for the passage of protein. But it's also now known that there are very important signaling pathways which are taking place through the basement membrane and through these proteins. So it's a medium for the crosstalk between podocyte and podocyte, endothelial cell and endothelial cell, as well as podocyte and the endothelial cells. Of course, it plays a very, very important role of anchoring the podocytes as well as the endothelial cells. Now, it is a very unique membrane because it is we can look at it, something like a sandbar between two islands. So it is a basement membrane which is formed as a result of the fusion of two basement membranes. A very elegant example of this is that collagen alpha, this collagen 4, which is alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 1, which is seen early in the development, is actually secreted by the endothelial cells. But the alpha 3, alpha 4, alpha 5 collagen is actually secreted by the podocyte. So in the early stages, it is the endothelial cells which are actually responsible for the development of the basement membrane. But later on, it is the podocyte which becomes the key player. It's also a very thick basement membrane. It is 300 to 350 nanometers thicker than the other basement membranes in the body. It also contains some unique proteins. So again, the four important components, type 4 collagen, laminin, nidogen, and heparin sulfate proteoglycan. Now, fibronectin has been described, but it's not a very important component in health. So this is the type 4 collagen. Each type 4 collagen, it actually consists of the monomeric molecules. These monomeric molecules have a non-collagenous end at the carboxy terminal, and they consist of these repeats, which is GlyXY. These GlyXY repeats actually give it the elasticity which collagen is known for. But the monomers, they are stapled together by the non-collagenous terminal, which form dimers, and finally they form tetramers. These tetramers are actually the units of collagen which hold the basement membrane together. So this type 4 collagen, since it's in the center of the basement membrane, it has a lot of structural importance. As it matures, the immature glomerulus requires something which is soft and which is a little more flexible. But as we grow up, we need a glomerular basement membrane which is a little stiffer and gives support against the shearing stress of the vascular endothelium, or rather the blood flow inside the glomerulus. Now, as it matures, we get from laminin alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 1, we get alpha 3, alpha 4, alpha 5. So there is a change in the chemistry of the collagen with time. This is the second molecule which is of immense importance. This is laminin. We can think of it as three threads. You know, those of us who are Brahmins and we wear a sacred thread, we have three threads which are all crossed around each other. So laminin can be thought of as something like that, and there is a knot at the end, which is the LG terminus. This LG terminus actually communicates with the molecules in the podocytes and holds the podocytes together. Whereas the molecules which are at the amino terminus, they are actually like people holding hands with each other, and they actually hold the laminin molecules together for the structural integrity of the basement membrane. Of course, alpha 5, beta 2, gamma 1 is the important heterotrimer. So one thing I did, it's known to all, but one thing which we all must keep in mind is that in the collagen, it is mutations in any of the chains which are either alpha 3, 4 or 5, most famously alpha 5, which is responsible for the hereditary nephropathy, which we known as Alport syndrome. And here, if there is a defect in the beta 2 laminin, we get a genetic form of nephrotic syndrome, which is known as Pearson syndrome. Since this beta 2 is also present in the eyes, we also get the ocular manifestation in the form of microchorea. Now, as we see, as it matures, there is again a change from laminin 111 to 521. So alpha 1, beta 1, gamma 1 becomes alpha 5, beta 2, gamma 1 as the glomerulus matures. Now, nidogen is a dumbbell-shaped protein which actually is useful for the connection of the laminin and the collagen. But the real function of nidogen is not known. Knockout and knockdown experiments did not show much of damage in experimental animals. Now, these are the heparin sulfate proteoglycans, syndecan, glypican, perlecan, agrin, and the type 18 collagen. Now, these molecules are negatively charged, and it was first believed that the negative charge of these molecules is important for the structural intactness of the glomerular filtration barrier. But again, we have knockout experiments in mice which did not show any significant proteinuria. So it is now believed that the negative charge of these heparin sulfate proteoglycans does not play a very important role. If at all, their role is in the this thing nitrogen to hold the basement membrane and the collagen and the laminin together. Again, as the glomerulus develops, we move from collagen and collagen 18 to agrin as the predominant heparin sulfate proteoglycan. So to recap, we have laminin, which is actually tethering the podocyte. We have collagen, which is giving it the backbone. And we have nidogen and the heparin sulfate proteoglycans, chiefly glycan, which are kind of holding them together. Now, with that, we come to the goalkeeper, the podocyte, the most glamorous part of the glomerular filtration barrier. So much of research is being done about it. Now, to take it on the lighter side, we've gotten a small meme here, but what I'm trying to communicate here is that the cell of the podocyte does not sit on the glomerular capillary. The connection between the podocyte and the glomerular capillary is just through the foot processes. The glomerular body actually is floating in the primary urine, which is formed. So podocytes are shaped like octopuses. The number of podocytes increase as we grow. So in the newborn period, we have approximately 326 glomeruli. And with maturation, as the glomerular size increases, we get closer to 600 glomeruli per, podocytes. I'm sorry. We get 589 podocytes per glomerulus. Each podocyte has got major processes, finer pedicels, and foot processes. The most important part is the foot process. This foot process is actually communicating with foot process of the adjacent podocyte using the slit diaphragms. These slit diaphragms are 200 nanometer gaps in between the two cells, and these are very important cell-cell junctions. If they are to function as a physical filter, they sieve proteins or other molecules which are at about 60 kilodalton. And there is, of course, over and above this, there is a cell a junction with the podocyte and the glomerular basement membrane. Now, these slit diaphragms, they interact with adhesion receptors. So that means that when there is contact between foot processes of adjacent podocytes at the slit diaphragm, there are a large number of molecules which are talking to each other. They can be homophobic, homophilic, heterophobic, and heterophilic. That means like and unlike, either attracting or repelling each other. But the most important interaction is the homophilic interaction between nephrin and nephron. Nephron is nothing but a nephrin-like protein, number one. And I'll be talking about this a little more. And the foot process is attached to the basement membrane through the integrin-laminin connection. Now, I'm saying this again and again because, you know, we keep forgetting it. The actin cytoskeleton is an important part of the foot process. I'll be describing this as well. Now, there is, while we think of these as structural barriers, we have to understand that there is a lot of outside in signaling which is happening through all these proteins, and there is also a lot of inside-out signaling which is happening. Now, these proteins, that is, integrin as well as nephrin, they talk to the actin inside through adapter molecules. We'll be discussing this subsequently. So in the immature glomerulus, the formifrusty podocytes are actually almost cylindrical cells which are talking to each other, which are connected to each other with tight junctions. Now, tight junctions contain a protein called zona occulans. And as with development, they become octopus shaped, and that's why the side-side attachment gives way to just an attachment between the foot processes. So at a particular point in development, we get an adhesin kind of a junction. So that's why we've got the cadherin protein. So either we have, so the tight junction makes way for an adherence junction, and the final slit diaphragm, which is the slit-slit junction, which is the slit diaphragm, which is the cell-cell junction, has got features of both tight as well as adherence junctions. So this is where it is. Just to recap, that there is a kidney, there is a nephron. In the nephron, there is an efferent and efferent glomerulus, which has been described, and there is a podocyte. The body does not sit on the glomerulus, but the food processes sit on it, and there are these slit diaphragms. Now, I'll take a small diversion into the concept of cytoskeletal responses, because whenever we study congenital nephrotic syndrome, we just hear these hi-fi words, formin, inverted formin, actin, myosin, and we really don't know what is happening. And so broadly what happens is that there are three types of cytoskeletal proteins, that is actin, intermediate tubules, and microtubules. And in the food process, what we have is a predominance of actin. Now, this actin is balanced between the monomeric actin and the polymeric actin, and it requires a fine balance. We don't know, in fact, whether more monomeric actin is good or bad. It is likely to be dependent on the cellular stress which the podocyte is undergoing. But what is important is that there needs to be a balance between the monomeric and polymeric forms. Too much is bad, too little is also bad. Now, the lamellipodia, you can think of it something like a pseudopodium formation. And phyllopodium is a slightly sharper version of the same. It is formed by parallel fibers which are polymeric. And at the end, so at the front end of the lamellipodium or the phyllopodium, we get the parallel fibers which are attached. So that means the head of one actin molecule is attached to the head of another actin molecule. And this takes place through the R2/3 signaling pathway and the formin pathway. Now, in the peculiar case of the podocyte, this formin is an inverted formin. So that's why mutations in the inverted formin pathway are associated with nephrotic congenital forms of nephrotic syndrome. Similarly, problems in the ARP2-3 pathway, which is typically the Rho GT phases, are also associated with congenital nephrotic syndrome. On the other hand, we have stress fibers, which are another form of cytoskeletal response, where the actin molecules are antiparallel. That means the head of one molecule is facing the tail of another molecule. And these are brought together by the linker molecules. There are a large number of linker molecules, such as alpha-actinin. And in the case of the podocyte, it is alpha-actinin 4. So mutations in alpha-actin ACTN4 are associated with hereditary forms of nephrotic syndrome. Now, the myosin which is in the podocyte, we all think of myosin as, you know, the muscle. But there is a non-muscular myosin. So there are MyH2 and MyH3, which are non-muscular forms of myosin, which are also important for the antiparallel arrangement. And they can actually cause contraction of the podocyte or, in fact, any cell in response to any cellular stress. So MYH09 is the gene which codes for the myosin 2. And that's why mutations in the MyH9 genes are associated with a picture which very closely resembles Alport syndrome, and it can also cause nephrotic range proteinuria. Now, this is a very interesting photograph which I'm sharing as I was looking up literature. After we thought that electron microscopy is the highest resolution of microscopy, there is helium-2 ion microscopy, which gives us even greater depth. And these are microvilli which are formed on the left side. These structures which are which actually look like bacterium with a spore at the end, they are microvilli, but which were always over the years considered an artifact of the electron microscopy. But now it is seen that they are actual structures which are present at the urinary end of the podocyte. But we don't know the function of these structures. And here we actually see the ladder-like slit diaphragms which are over here. So they can be considered to be like a zipper where the nephrin-nephrin or the nephrin-nephron connections are there, and they leave very small 200 nanometers gaps. Now, on top, on the right side, we can see that these slit diaphragm junctions have become relatively larger, and therefore this is a podocyte in some sort of pathology. So now we talk about the actin-associated proteins. Now this is where it all makes sense. where you know we have a large number of proteins which are associated. For instance, the F-actin is the one which is polymerized. We talked about a synaptocodein, which assists alpha-actinin in keeping the F-actin polymerized. We talk about paladin also, which is associated with these polymers. And mutations in each of these can be associated with some sort of a pathology, either in the human or the mouse models. On the other hand, we have proteins like the SMPDL, which are associated, which are important housekeeping proteins, which again crosstalk with actin. And that's why if we have calcineurin, then we know that it can cause a monomerization of the actin. And that's why calcineurin inhibitors, apart from their immunomodulatory role, can also act directly on the podocyte to mitigate proteinuria. And we have the role of glucocorticoids. So there is, in other words, an intricate biology within the podocyte, which is, of course, being discovered gradually. And there are more than 90 molecules in whom mutations are associated with congenital forms of nephrotic syndrome. So this is, of course, an insight into the nephrin. So as we can see that there is a nephrin-nephrin junction over here, and there is a NEF1, which is we can consider it like the chota bhai of nephrin. So it's a small molecule like nephrin. So that's why it's called nephrin-like. So we have other molecules. So nephrin is the chief molecule at the slit diaphragm. We also have molecules such as FAT1, durexin, ephrin, and of course nephron by itself. Now, these are all important for intracellular signaling, but the most important one is nephrin per se. Ephrin becomes important in situations of pathology. If it is stimulated, the podocyte becomes motile. Podocin is an important molecule because it's a kind of chaperone which actually ensures that the nephrin is brought to its place. So it is like the class monitor which tells, make sure that all the nephrin molecules are sitting in their place. So it brings nephrin to the lipid raft of the podocyte foot process. The PAR-PKC group of molecules are important for the planar cell polarity of the podocyte. So CD2, AP and NCK are important adapter molecules which connect the nephrin to the actin molecule, not only physically but also through intracellular signaling. We've talked about synaptocodein, and we come here where again this is a model where ephrin can stimulate cell migration. This is not a very important mechanism in health. It takes over in disease. So this is the important part where we can see that the nephrin molecule has got 8 IgG-like domains in the extra cellular domain. These IgG-like domains make it a part of the immunoglobulin superfamily. And proximal to that, we have the fibronectin-like moiety. We have a transmembranous domain, and we have an intracellular domain. Now, the IgG-like domains attach to each other in the neighboring podocytes. And as they attach to each other and based on various stimuli, there is intracellular signaling. Now, what is this intracellular signaling? The intracellular domain of the nephrin molecule has got tyrosine-rich moieties. These moieties, if they get phosphorylated, they start intracellular communication, and then they talk to actin, making it either polymerize or depolymerize or inhibit polymerization depending on the signal. So this signaling is very, very important, not only for the podocyte survival, it is also important for nephrin trafficking. So nephrin is not just present at the cell surface, it is present. After some time, it has to be brought inside, a fresh nephrin molecule comes in, and this dynamic action is also very important, and this is regulated by the signaling. And most important is the cytoskeletal organization, which is by a mechanism called phosphoregulation. Now again, we don't know which is good more or less, but in all probability, it is in the situation in which the podocyte is. So every situation of stress to the podocyte gives a particular response, and this gets blunted or gets altered in the state of disease. This science is yet unraveling. So this is the nephrin acting signaling which is taking place. So as we can see that at the cell-cell junction at the slit diaphragm, there's not just nephrin, but there is podocin, NEF1, FAT, TRPC6, JAM4, cadherins, lot of molecules. But most of the talking is being done by nephrin. And it talks through the adapter molecules, which are like zona occulans 1, NCK, CDTOP, MAG1, and so on. And then they, which again in turn talk to the molecules, which are the effector molecules, which finally take a final action on actin, depending, and then they decide whether to polymerize or depolymerize this actin. Now, this is at the site. Now, there is also signaling which is happening at the base of the podocyte, which is the junction at the basement membrane. So we can see here that this is our the same laminin molecule which we saw. Now it has been turned over upside down, and the LG domain of the laminin molecule is talking to the integrin alpha 3 beta 1. CD151 is a molecule which is associated with this, and it actually stabilizes this junction. And we have molecules in the middle which are the adapter molecules like talin, vinculin, paxilin. So, apart from integrin, the basement membrane, the podocyte is attached to the basement membrane also through other proteins like dystroglycan and syndecan-4. And now the role of these molecules have also been noticed, where knockout experiments and animals have shown proteinuria. So every part of the podocyte has a particular role. But yes, if there is one molecular interaction which has to be kept in mind, it is the laminin-integrin interaction which has to be kept in mind. So again, we have this signaling. Again, we have lots of molecules at the junction of the podocyte and the basement membrane. But the most important molecule is the integrin, which through a large number of adapter molecules and effector molecules, again, affects the polymerization and depolymerization of actin. So in other words, it's the actin in the podocyte which is doing everything. Now, coming to the mesangium, which is again an important part of the podocyte, of the glomerular filtration barrier. Now, whenever we say glomerular filtration barrier, we just say on one end endothelium, on one end basement membrane, one end podocyte, and that too just the food process. In fact, not just the food process, just the slit diaphragm. We call this the basement, the glomerular filtration barrier. The mesangium also has a role to play. And the mesangium can be, you know, considered something like the substitute football player who comes into play when someone gets injured. So as we can see, the mesangial cells are not just, you know, inside, they are not just the extras in a Bollywood movie. They have a connection with the podocytes as well as the endothelial cells. So as we can see here, there is a junction between a mesangial cell and a podocyte. We can see over here that there is a communication between the mesangium and the glomerular capillary wall, and of course they do talk to each other as well. So the mesangial cells, they are specialized pericytes. Now every tissue of the body has a pericyte. The glial cells in the brain take on the role of a pericyte. They communicate with the podocytes as well. Now why is this communication with the podocyte important? Because this podocyte actually causes contractility of these mesangials. And as Dr. Nivedita brought out, they control the single nephron GFR by constriction and dilatation of the glomerular arteriole. Now, of course, this is not the only mechanism, but it is an important mechanism. Now, the endothelium is very important for the upkeep of the mesangial cells. Because it secretes PDGF. If we knock off PDGF, we lose the mesangial cells. And if we lose the mesangial cells, we also lose the mesangial matrix because it is being secreted by the mesangial cells. So the endothelial secretion of PDGF is very, very important to this. And the role of the role of the mesangial cells is control of the single nephron GFR, generating the mesangial matrix, housekeeping functions. And should there be some leak of the macromolecules, it is cleared by phagocytosis. This is the mesangial matrix. The component is very, very similar to that of the glomerular basement membrane. But yes, fibronectin is an important component in health itself. And of course, we have other molecules like chondroitin sulfate. Now, this is important for structural support, matrix cell signaling. It also influences mesangial cell proliferation and growth because it binds to the growth factors. And should, again, some micromolecules leak out, it clears these macromolecules by trafficking in the cleft-like spaces. Now, we've studied all the components of the glomerular filtration barrier, but what is the point in learning just the actors in a play unless you know what is the script of the play? And this is where, you know, science is at its weakest. We really don't know how this whole thing works. How is this football being played? So for it to be, for this phenomenon to be understood, a large number of phenomena need to be explained. That is the retention of albumin and other macromolecules. How albumin and antibodies appear in the blood, in the urine when the blood flow reduces. What is this phenomenon of PLA2R antibodies in anti-GBM disease? How, the most importantly, this enigma that there is perm selectivity without clogging. This filter just does not get clogged. Even in proteinuric diseases, this filter does not get clogged. This is something which we take for granted, but we don't understand. Even if we knock out some parts of the basement membrane, there is we don't get nephrotic syndrome very often. And on the other hand, if there is something with the food processes, there is heavy proteinuria. So food process effacement and proteinuria are almost together. However, of course, there are exceptions to this rule as well. So there are a large number of models which have come into play, like the pore model, electrokinetic model, gel hypothesis, gel permeation, and extended permeation. For paucity of time, we can't go into all of them. But we have to understand that the fundamental question which was asked by scientists is that which is the most selective part of the barrier? Is it the innermost or the outermost? Now, when we talk about innermost, we talk about the podocyte. So if it is the slit diaphragm which is the most selective barrier, it's very difficult to understand how this barrier does not get clogged, because there will be proteins in the middle. If we talk about just electro-repulsion, it's again very difficult to explain how the filter does not get clogged. So I'll just describe some models. So the first model which we were taught from MBBS was the two pore model, where mathematically it was predicted that there will be small pores which let in the fluid, let in the micro and the medium sized molecules, but stop the big molecules. There are large pores here and there which allow a little bit of passage of the macromolecules. Here the forces, the fluxes which drive filtration are just convection and diffusion. Now, this model has largely fallen apart because it cannot explain the filter not getting clogged. And the most important thing is that these pores were never really found on ultrastructural or electron microscope studies. Now, what came in through very elegant experiment is something called the electrokinetic model, where we see that as the blood flow increases, there is an electrical field which is generated in the glomerular capillary. So what actually is happening is that the anions get adhered to the negatively charged glycocalyx and they actually cause a charge reversal. On the other hand, the cations enter the urinary space, and that's why there is an electric field which is generated, but this is dependent on the flow. The higher the flow, the stronger the field. Now, this field is what is keeping the albumin out of the glomerular, out of the urine. Most macromolecules are negatively charged, and that's why this model seems to be quite elegant. On the other hand, some positively charged molecules may find themselves in the primary urine and they are removed by the proximal tubular cells. Neutrally charged molecules may find themselves in the basement membrane. There are very few such neutral molecules, but they can be taken up by phagocytosis by the podocytes, and this has been shown experimentally as well. There is also the gel permeation model, where it is said that just like a large number of children, or humans holding hands, we've played this game called Sher Bakri, where, there is a strength which is we talk about unity being strength. So a large number of podocytes are holding themselves together and they create a kind of buttress which keeps the glomerular basement membrane, compact and prevent the permeation of the proteins. On the other hand, if there is a flattening of the glomerular cells, now this actually weakens the spores, and that's why it causes a bit of decompaction of the basement membrane. And it makes this barrier sensitive to the shear stress as well as the hydrostatic pressure of the glomerular flow. And that's why this causes a diffusion of the molecules. Now, this is important because this also explains, otherwise one would think that food process effacement should actually, reduce the proteinuria. This is what explains the food process. So no model is really perfect, but we can take in a functional part of each of these models. So I think this slide got duplicated. It was a hidden slide, I suppose. Now, I'll skip the slide for shortage of time. But before, I think I'll just skip this slide because I think time is running out. We'll just look at some models of glomerular injury. So we have a large number of models of inherited glomerular injury where, you know, where the congenital forms of nephrotic syndrome can be associated with podocyte problems. We can have the basopathies in the basement membrane. We can have problems. We can have the genetic forms of, hemolytic uremic syndrome, which disrupt the glomerulus. And we have, also storage disorders, which can cause a problem. We can also see that there is immune and non-immune mechanism of injury. There are some viruses which can directly affect the podocytes and cause a podocytopathy. But what is important to understand is that each cell type in the glomerular filtration barrier has its own peculiar response to injury. In the case of the podocyte, it is most often food process effacement or the loss of the podocyte itself. The anchorage is lost and the podocyte is lost in the urine, apoptosis, podocyturea. So it can be considered that if there is no change in, it's just food process effacement, we get minimal change disease. If there is podocyte detachment or death, we get FSGS. And if there is podocyte proliferation, we get mesangial sclerosis or the DMS at low levels of proliferation. And at high levels of proliferation, we get the collapsing glomerulopathy. It is also an interesting fact that if a particular glomerulus loses about 40% of its podocytes, it reaches a point of no return. And this glomerulus is going to be lost. One cell type which we didn't discuss at all is the parietal epithelial cell. The parietal epithelial cells has got some podocytes which are in quiescence. This CXCL2 pathway which I talked about keeps them in quiescence. So in response to podocyte loss, these parietal cells can give us some podocytes which can be replaced. But this process usually, more often than not, in the fulminant forms of disease is ineffective. And that's why it is either hyperactive or inactive. And that's why we get a response which is towards scar formation rather than repair. Of course, there are other forms of response to injury. The mesenchymal cells proliferate. Now, this is most elegantly demonstrated in IgA nephropathy. The endothelial cells usually acquire a prothrombotic phenotype, or they can even proliferate. The prothrombotic phenotype is seen in HUS. But of course, what affects one cell can also affect another. That's why we get podocytopathy in HUS and IgA nephropathy. Very often on kidney biopsy and idiopathic nephrotic syndrome, we get MESPGN, mesangioproliferative glomerulonephritis reported. And so to summarize, the glomerular filtration barrier consists of endothelial, basement membrane, podocytes, as well as mesangial cells, free passage of water in small solutes, and in fact, even intermediate solutes, but it's a barrier to albumin and the macromolecules. The endothelium is 20% fenestrated, and it has an endothelial surface layer, which is an important part of the barrier. The basement membrane consists of the important parts of the type 4 collagen, which give it a backbone, and laminin, which tethers the podocytes. The podocytes have major processes and the foot processes and talk to each other through the slit diaphragms. The nephrin and integrin signaling, which regulates actin polymerization, is the important part of the glomerular filtration barrier and podocyte survival. The models of glomerular filtration barrier include the pore, electrokinetic, and the extended gel permeation models. And the cells of the glomerular filtration barrier have a common response to injury through a variety of injuries. With this, I close my presentation and thank you. This is my hospital, INHS Ashwini. It's a naval hospital in Mumbai. It's a teaching hospital and it's the largest hospital of the Indian Navy.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ranjit. The glomerular filtration barrier has been made interesting by you. And I think Dr. Ranjit is a very much sports-oriented person. He has linked the whole glomerular filtration barrier with sports activities. Can we take up the questions? There are a few questions which has dropped in the session and few in the WhatsApp and mail. Can we take up questions? Namal Basar, do you have anything to add on Dr. Ranjit's talk, sir?
No, Ma, it's a wonderful talk, Ma. Really gone deep into the glomerular filtration barrier. I must congratulate you. Go on to questions and answers. No?
Okay, sir. We'll take up the questions. There are a few comments. I think it's for Dr. Nivedita. Dr. Nivedita, you're there, ma'am. Dr. Nivedita? There is a request. Can you please repeat the afferent and efferent arteriolar dilatation effect slide? I think the recorded session will be available. I don't think it is possible for the speaker to repeat it again. The next question is, how is SGLT2 useful in non-diabetic kidney disorders, and should we try it in children? Dr. Nivedita?
So, what the SGLT inhibitors, of course, I should... Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, we are able to hear you, ma'am.
Yeah. So I must say that I'm not an expert on SGLT inhibitors, but whatever I know about it, it has definitely been proven by multiple mechanisms to reduce the progression or retard the progression of CKD in diabetic kidney disease, and is now being used as a very important drug in the prevention of CKD or prevention of progression of CKD in diabetic kidney disease. However, there is, I think over the last couple of years, there has been more and more data that's coming up on the use of SGLT inhibitors in non-diabetic kidney disease as well. And this is because there are multiple mechanisms by which it retards the progression independent of its hypoglycemic or anti-hypoglycemic effect. So I think the recent studies have shown that it has not only in reducing the cardiovascular, not only in reducing the progression of CKD, but also improving cardiovascular outcomes in non-diabetic kidney disease. And so definitely there is a lot of scope for its use in non-diabetic kidney disease. I think the second part of the question was whether we can use it in children. Am I right?
Yeah, yes, ma'am.
So I don't think there is any data so far on the use. Theoretically, I think it's a very interesting avenue that should be studied. If there is enough data in adults with non-diabetic kidney disease, I'm sure in the near future there will be studies in children as well, because the mechanisms of progression of CKD may be the same. The only thing would be safety and efficacy data. So in the absence of data, it's very hard to recommend its use, but there is no reason why it should not be, at least as far as I know.
Thank you, ma'am. Next is for Dr. Ranjit. There is a request to repeat about the calcineurin protein. Mechanism of action of calcineurin protein.
Should I go to the slide? I think I'll...
Yeah, even that is fine. If you want to go back to the slides, it's still okay with me.
Yeah, so I think this is where I mentioned calcineurin. So calcineurin is, we read about calcineurin chiefly in the context of the T lymphocytes, but in the context of the podocyte, it actually is a signaling molecule which actually increases the transcription of a large number of proteins. The net effect of these transcription of these proteins is in different circumstances, it again goes towards actin polymerization or depolymerization. But it is known that if there is excessive calcineurin signaling, the balance between the monomeric and polymeric actin is lost, and we get food process effacement. That is how the calcineurin inhibitors are said to have a direct role on the podocyte in reducing the podocyturea. However, at the same time, most of the studies in genetic forms of nephrotic syndrome where calcineurin inhibitors were exhibited, they did not have so much of effect. And now in monogenic nephrotic syndrome, we don't recommend calcineurin inhibitors anymore. So this slide, I would say, is chiefly theoretical and not really from a clinical perspective very, very important.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. And the next question is to Dr. Nivedita. What are the contributory factors for hyperfiltration in nephrotic syndrome? Is it artifactual due to the low creatinine or a real one? What is the clinical relevance and implication? I think we'll, there are two
I think, such as Dr. Ranjit, throughout his talk, has mentioned several ways in which. Yeah. So I think the major thing, the major, of course, there are different types of nephrotic syndrome. We cannot really put them all into one when we are looking at the pathophysiology. But I think the major, if you have to sum it up in one word, it is the abnormality or the disruption of the glomerular filtration barrier. Now, it may be with the effacement of the food process of the podocytes, or it may be because of damage to the glomeruli, which causes, you know, increased sort of hyperfiltration to the remaining glomeruli. So it may be, it is multifactorial, and it is depending on the pathophysiology. Dr. Ranjit, would you want to add on to this?
No, nothing really, nothing much more. It's just that maybe one of the, like there was one paper where they did notice that, report that the creatinine clearance was a little higher. But then if it is measured as creatinine, it has its own, you know, drawbacks because of the catabolic state itself.
Okay. The next question, there are a few comments in the boxes. It was an excellent conference. Thank you. Nice presentation by both the speakers. There are a few questions in the mail. Can I read out the questions? Most of the questions is for Dr. Nivedita. Nivedita ma'am, you're there?
Yes, yes, please.
Like in a nephrotic syndrome child, is there any, does albumin infusion increases the GFR?
So in a nephrotic syndrome child,
Yes, I can hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I'm able to hear you.
Yes. So in nephrotic syndrome, I don't think that the, because generally albumin, the nephrotic syndrome is a state of hypoalbuminemia. So we know that even when we give albumin, the albumin rarely comes up to even normal. And whatever albumin is given is lost in the urine because of various reasons. So I don't think it generally has much of a bearing as such on the glomerular filtration rate. Maybe transient changes may happen, but I don't think it's a sustained effect because whatever albumin is given is ultimately lost in the urine.
Next question is for, again, to Dr. Nivedita. What are the factors that can influence the rate of filtration? I think you have already mentioned in that slides. Would you like to repeat it, ma'am?
Yeah, so the important factors that maintain the glomerular filtration rate, other than the renal blood flow, of course, the renal blood flow is the most important. The other important thing is the status of the afferent and the efferent arterioles. So to maintain the glomerular filtration rate, which technically happens between these two arterioles, we need to have the afferent arteriole in a dilated state and the efferent arteriole in a constricted state. So these are the two important factors that increase the glomerular filtration rate or maintain the glomerular filtration rate in pathological conditions. Other than this, there is a, so the increased blood flow in turn increases the glomerular hydraulic pressure, which is the most important determinant of the glomerular filtration rate. In pathological conditions, we may see that the surface area of the capillary loops may be reduced, the permeability coefficient may be altered, there may be increase in the hydrostatic pressure within the Bowman's capsule because of obstruction of the tubules. So all these could also have a some impact on the glomerular filtration rate.
Okay.
Then, of course, we have the extensive substances like angiotensin, the vasoconstrictors and the vasodilators, as we have discussed. The most important is the renin-angiotensin and aldosterone system, of which angiotensin 2 is the most important substance which maintains the GFR in pathological conditions.
Fine. The next question is again to Dr. Nivedita. The blood flow in kidneys and other organs, the arteriovenous oxygen difference is around 12 to 15. Does it depend on the reabsorption of sodium? Should I repeat the question again?
Sorry, the arteriovenous?
No, yeah, the blood flow in kidneys and other organs, it all depends on the arteriovenous oxygen difference, which is around 12 to 15 in kidneys. Does it depend on the reabsorption of sodium?
No, I really didn't understand the question. I'm sorry.
No, like the question is like a little tricky. Like they mean to ask whether the AV oxygen difference in kidneys is around 12 to 15. Whether this difference is basically, yes, it depends on the reabsorption of sodium.
No, I don't know the answer to that.
Probably we'll look into this and let you know later. Okay, the next question is again to Dr. Nivedita. What is the role of ANP, atrial natriuretic peptide, in regulation of GFR?
So the atrial natriuretic peptide has a, as we know, that it's stimulated by the dilatation or the increased volume in the right atrium, and it's produced in wherever there is a excess volume state, and the main function is, as the name describes, natriuresis, or excreting this extra salt and water. So it causes the dilatation of the afferent arteriole and causes increase in the GFR. That is a major role of the atrial natriuretic peptide in relation to the glomerular hemodynamics.
Okay.
So it has also an important role, say, in a pathological condition like CCF, where there is a chronic volume overload state which dilates the right atrium and releases atrial natriuretic peptide. And though the systemic blood pressure may be low and the renal blood flow may be reduced, by dilatation of the afferent arteriole, it helps in maintaining the GFR in these sort of chronic volume overloaded states.
Okay. One last question in the mail. What is the myogenic mechanism of the autoregulation?
So myogenic response is basically an intrinsic response of the afferent arteriole, in which, in response to a high blood pressure, the arterial wall is stretched. In response to this stretched stimulus of stretch, there is an increase in the intracellular calcium release. So this calcium release in the intracellular space of the arteriole causes vasoconstriction and hence reduces the blood flow. So it is a very sort of a reflex response to a transient it's mostly to a transient increase in the blood pressure, which increases the flow to the vessel.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. I think we are done with the questions as well. I think it was an extensive and an excellent session by the two speakers, Dr. Nivedita and Dr. Ranjit. I think we have one more question which has come now. What is a normal intraglomerular pressure?
So the normal intraglomerular pressure, as we said, is maintained at a constant of around 60 millimeters of mercury in normal adults with a normal blood pressure. It may vary, of course, in like say a neonate who has a lower systemic blood pressure, or in a hypertensive patient who has abnormal pathophysiology and an abnormal mean arterial pressure itself. But in a normal person, the intraglomerular pressure is maintained at around 60 millimeters of mercury.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. It was an excellent session by Dr. Ranjit and Dr. Nivedita, covering on all about glomerular hemodynamics and glomerular filtration barrier. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you, Dr. Ranjit. Thank you, Dr. Nivedita. Namal Vasa, do you have anything to add on, sir?
I just subscribe to your statements, ma'am. Really an excellent presentation. And I think I'll call it as a professorial lectures, both of you. Congratulations. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Ranjit. Thank you, Dr. Niveda. Thank you. I just have one small announcement. From next session, we'll be having our polling sessions, and we request all the participants whoever are willing for the polling session to use their iPads or bigger monitors so that you can view the questions in a single set, because we'll be having the polling sessions only for 10 minutes and it is 10 questions, and the cumulative results will be considered for the winners. Thank you so much. Thank you, Namal Vasa. Thank you, Dr. Anjit. Thank you, Dr. Niveta.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for this opportunity.
Congratulations, Dr. Niveta and Dr. Anjit. Wonderful lecture.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Really
appreciate Thank you for the opportunity.
I'm thrilled.
Thank you very
thank
much.
You.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.